Thanks for coming out on a Sunday night. Really appreciate it, and hope it'll be a useful and interesting conversation. Our agenda basically is as follows. We're going to ask Robert Liberty to speak for about 45 minutes. What I can tell you is that he is a confirmed visual learner and will be using visuals, and that's great for the visual learners in the room, and you know who you are. Then we'll have a brief response by three panelists from the community and city staff, just based on what they've seen, what they've heard, any responses they want to provide. And then from there, we'll go to about a half an hour of Q&A. We'll use the microphones. This is being recorded. So we'll have it's not streaming live, but we'll have an opportunity to ask some questions either of Robert and or of the panel. I'll introduce the panelists when we come to that part, but for now, let me just introduce Robert Liberty. He's currently the director of the Urban Sustainability Accelerator at Portland State University. He's a graduate of the Harvard Law School. He's worked in many roles at basically all levels of government to promote livable and sustainable cities and regions. As staff attorney and then executive director of the 1,000 Friends of Oregon, he played a critical role in making Portland a national model for livable communities. He served as senior counsel to Congressman Earl Blumenauer of Oregon, assisting him with federal policy issues concerning livable communities. And in 2004, was actually elected to the Metro Council. That's the metropolitan government in the Portland region, and was reelected to that post in 2008. And then became director of the Urban Sustainability Accelerator in 2012. He's no stranger to Davis, actually. He's been here and will be returning. He's been working with the Davis Joint Unified School District to brainstorm potential redevelopment options for the district property, which is just across the street here. And just raise your hand if you went to any of the brainstorming sessions on that. So some of you have met Robert and his team, and they've been at the market as well. So we're really happy to have Robert with us and look forward to his talk. And as I said, when we're done, we'll have some responses by a few panelists. So Robert, go ahead and take it away.
Thank you.
Thanks
Thank
for coming.
It's a somewhat intimidating audience, not just for the reputation of the city of Davis, but also people in this room have a lot of accumulated experience. And maybe if I stay in the field another 20 or 30 years, I can come back and be their peers. But in the meantime, I'm here representing myself, not an institution, and my own views. So I've been to Davis long enough, or enough times, to develop personal friendships with typical representative Davisites. And I think it's very important to know a community in order to speak knowledgeably about its needs. You have to understand things like what this house represents. So a little bungalow built in the 1940s was a place, an accessible kind of home for people after World War II, now valued $400,000 to $500,000. In a neighborhood of other bungalows, also now at very high prices, unaffordable to many people, but having certainly a lot of charm. A place where there is a lot of people on bikes all the time, a lot of amenities, including things that are very close to you, like a farmer's market. And that because of far-seeing policies, the city comes to an end and you come to farmland. And of course, there's a certain bluish cast to the politics in the county. All of it overseen by a governor named Brown. Actually, it's Governor Kate Brown. And all the images I showed you were from my own neighborhood in Portland. So there is plenty in common, although there are definitely differences. But what I'm going to describe and what I'll show you is what I've experienced, and I think you'll see that there are things in common. In fact, if you were to pick a peer for the Portland metropolitan region out of the entire United States, you know, a city with which it would have the most in common, that would, of course, be this region. Two regions of about 2.4 million people, the largest cities in the Pacific Coast states that aren't on salt water. Both of them on a major river in a major agricultural valley. So, and by the way, now have very similar home prices. So these are places that, despite obvious differences, do have a lot in common. And of course, this winter you've actually had our weather. I'm going to talk a little bit about the context and then how it's expressed at this neighborhood and level and city level. So every city in Oregon has an urban growth boundary. In fact, there are a few cities that have a population less than this room. They have urban growth boundaries. And over the years, they've been implemented. This is the city of McMinnville, a city of about 28,000. You can actually see the urban growth boundary. So this is familiar to you in Davis. It'd be familiar to people in Woodland, for that matter. Right across the river from part of the Portland metropolitan area is Washington State, which has its own Growth Management Act. Each of those red dots represents a new house built since the turn of the century to 2010. So you can see there's quite a difference in performance in terms of protection of working landscapes between Oregon and our sister state, Washington. And this is a map that I had commissioned when I was on the Metro Council. I said, where have the houses been built in the last 10 years? And it turned out they looked at 11 and a half years. There were 69,965 housing units built during that period. And this shows where they're located. The aqua are single-family homes. The dark blue are multifamily homes. And one of the mayors of the suburbs looked at it and said, Robert, I don't understand. There's no pattern. He's now on the Metro Council, by the way. And I said, Craig, the pattern is infill and redevelopment. So there's not as much development as the edge as there is in the core. It's a little hard to see the lighter single-family homes. But basically, the pattern is the reason he said there was no pattern was because he was expecting the pattern to look like the patterns of the 60s, 70s, 80s, or 90s. Growth at the edge, nothing at the center. And what you're finding is distributed across the landscape. This is the, I know I can only do this in Davis because you're all wonks just from having lived here and breathed the air. So I can show things like this graph. This shows where all the housing units went during that period. So 90% of them went into the central urban growth boundary for the 25 cities and three counties for Portland. And then the gold or light orange is the other urban growth boundaries. Blue is rural residential, which is really pre-existing sprawl that predated 1979 or 80. And then the rest are in farm and forest zones, which is about 90% of the land area. This is now pretty dated, but this is at a metropolitan scale, the Oregon part of the region, I should say, which is about 70% of the population of the region. This is the percentage of residential development that's infill and redevelopment. And it's pretty clear now that it's well over 50%, well over 50%. So the dominant pattern of residential development and increasingly employment development is not greenfield development, not at the edge, but redevelopment in the center. This is a comparison of 1990 to 2000 growth patterns between Charlottesville, North Carolina, and the Portland region. And I drew in the urban growth boundary, but you wouldn't even need it drawn in to show how the population is being settled. So there's a vast difference in what a community is like when you focus on building on existing communities and existing strength on existing public investments versus growing out. So a lot of Charlotte's growth is at, you know, 2, 4, 10, 20 acre home sites. Yes, and much worse than anything you see around here. But this is very common for the United States. In fact, the eight largest urban areas in Oregon, which includes some cities about the size of Davis, have grown almost twice as fast as the average United States and use one half as much land. So it's a fundamentally different pattern of growth now. So I'm going to talk about this connection between the overall larger objective, and obviously stopping sprawl has a lot of other benefits for the planet, for wildlife, for water, for infrastructure, for taxpayers. But I'm going to focus on this reinvesting in existing neighborhoods and downtowns. I'm going to begin with the kind of smallest unit of change. Accessory dwelling units, which we're trying to teach ourselves to call small backyard homes and internal apartments. No one knows what an ADU is, right? Although, of course, in Portland, you can probably hear it from your Lyft driver when you're coming from the airport. I want to acknowledge Cole Peterson's website. It's called accessorydwellingunits.org. And there's an amazing set of case studies on this website. And I've used some of his images. Others are photographs I've taken. I'm working with Cole on a project. We may have time to talk about it later. So this is an internal accessory dwelling unit is actually a garage or a basement on a slope, and it's in actually the northern part of the city of Portland looking across to Forest Park. It's just a few hundred square feet. Accessory dwelling units are, the largest is 800 square feet authorized in the city of Portland. Here's another one, a garage conversion. Another. This is one built new into a house about two blocks from where I live. You can see the entrance on the side, then they have French doors, so there's some light coming in. I tell you that's very important in Portland. So these are all internal units. This is my neighbor's house. Actually, he's now on the Metro Council. He had the position I had. So I got to make this joke. He lives in that wing that's like an accessory unit on the left. And I say, they say, well, how's Bob doing in the Metro Council? I said, he's great, but, you know, he looks down on me. So now the main house is occupied by the children and the grandchildren. So that's an attached accessory dwelling. And these are examples of detached. So these are small backyard homes. This is about a 420 square foot cottage. I think it's being used for someone's parents, ultimately for them. You notice, by the way, it's close to the setback property line. Here's another one, smaller, I think probably under 400 square feet, cottage. This is one friends of mine built about five blocks away. It's the location of the garage. It's about the footprint of the garage. I think it's probably just barely over 400 square feet. And then an older one that's about 10 blocks away, two stories. And finally, a more robust one that's just been completed about half a mile from where I live. So they're on the same property as the main house. They don't have to, there's certain requirements that they have to resemble the roof pitch in some of the windows if they're larger, but not so much if they're smaller. Many people choose to make them blend in. This is across the street from me. It's just being finished. There's actually paint samples. And this is an accessory dwelling unit over a garage. And unlike the others, I actually know them, so they're just moving in. This is part of the main floor. Master bedroom upstairs. This year so far, people have filed 600 permits for accessory dwelling units in Portland, and it is taking off very rapidly. We're involved in a project to make it much easier to build them. If you have questions about that, I'll be glad to talk about it, because I think we will have time. Missing middle housing, this is a phrase that's gained a certain amount of currency around the United States. And here are illustrations of what it is. So it's basically duplexes, triplexes, fourplexes, things that look like boarding houses. And they were built all over the United States in cities, big and small, for a long time until prohibited by zoning. To illustrate how this looks ensemble, I use these Google Earth images from a street I lived on for many years. It's actually very hard to get the images because the trees obscure things from Google Earth. So I took this aerial view, and what you see there is on the right is a courtyard complex. I lived in an identical one that you see at the end of the street. In between those two garden court apartment buildings are three single-family homes. On the other side of the street are three single-family homes, and then an apartment building that has about 12 units. The garden court apartments, I think, have about 18 or 19 each. This is another view. It gives you a better idea. You can see the white roof on the apartment. And then there's the edge of the apartment. And obscured is another building that's in back of that tree in the middle of the picture. And then that gray building that looks like a Dutch colonial home, I lived there for about 10 years. It's a fourplex. It's a shotgun fourplex. You could design these to all have four separate yards. And light on three sides. Very, very appealing design. Not, I don't think an architect designed. I think this was a standard design from about 1915. This is a picture of the garden court apartments. I lived there for about 5 years. Then in between that, the other brick building, this one back here, and our house was this. This is a threeplex. And this, by the way, is what the fourplex looks like. In fact, someone said, I said, yeah, I live in the fourplex. And they said, I thought you lived on Quimby. And I said, I did. And it used to be blue. He said, the blue house with the Dutch colonial war. I said, yeah. And he said, there's four apartments there? And I said, yes. He said, oh, my God, I thought it was a commune. and you could redesign these again to have four, so you have a shared entrance in front and back and have 4 yards if you wanted. So it's a very adaptable design. I'm going to talk about low to mid-rise, starting out with something that you've had some experience with here in Davis. And this is not from Portland. This is from White Salmon, Washington, cluster cottage housing. So the homes are 300 to about 700 square feet. What's wonderful about them, and I took a pretty famous landscape architect from China here, and showing them things in the Northwest, I feel like I'm showing them miniatures, because the scale at which they do things in China is so gigantic, you know. But he really was impressed, and he asked about the maintenance of the landscape. And I said, well, it's a homeowners association, so you don't have to take care of anything. It's got advanced sustainability features, and particularly around water. This is a semi-arid area. So this is actually, it can be quite a bit higher density than existing single-family homes on 6,000 square foot lots. Still lots of green. These are two projects that are pretty interesting. The one on the right is senior housing commissioned by about seven or eight families, seniors. It's passive solar, passive energy, which means it's net zero for energy consumption. In fact, it produces slightly more than it uses. One of the fellows said, if it's a cold day, if we get really cold, we could turn on a hairdryer. But mostly it's their body heat that warms it. And I'm going to show you the interior. And then off to the left, you can see some wood-clad buildings. These are actually very small studio units. And this might surprise you, but you're looking at the building to the right continues, but you're looking at about almost 30 units. This is a close-up of the senior co-housing. This is interior, the first year after it was planted. So there's an interior garden, quite beautiful. And they have a guest house as well. This is the entrance, this is in that senior housing looking toward these very small studio apartments. And this is the entrance into the studios. So they're quite small, but that also makes them much more affordable. And they all have separate entrances. So there's no common entrance. This is a completely different kind of building. This is a skinny house built without much in requirement of a setback, but on half-size lots. By the way, if it's not clear already, you are not required to like anything I show you. That is not what this is about. You're getting a sampler or a smorgasbord, and if you don't like pickled herring, you don't have to eat it, right? So, but I'm showing you what is happening when you allow infill and redevelopment, what it looks like, and the different forms it takes. This is actually, maybe it isn't compelling to you, it's often complimented. A woman, I think it was one of her first works as an architect, built this mixed-use project. It's just got two units upstairs and two commercial spaces downstairs. There's something about the proportions that almost everyone talks about how handsome it is. A building designed by another person with design training. It's got commercial and three units. He lives on the upper floor and has a beautiful roof deck with views of the city. This is on the street near, Arterial Street near where I live, which has undergone a remarkable, none of these are downtown, by the way, remarkable transformation. There was an old house on this property, and it was, I wouldn't say it was unusual, but it was handsome, a sort of typical early 20th century Portland Foursquare. And they saved it and moved it to another corner of the property, then built this, which has a pass-through going to a backyard garden with commercial space, a very unusual design. This is the house that they moved. And there is a lot of sustainability features, and they celebrate that on the outside of the building. There are also townhomes of different types. This is a mixed income community in a working class suburb of Portland called Milwaukee. It's just a really beautiful rain garden in the middle. And now you may have noticed that most of the new housing does not try and pretend it's from an earlier era. The architecture is contemporary architecture. But there are efforts to make things blend in, although it might be a little bit of a problem with hyperthyroidism in the case of this structure. But and this is one that's going to be built fairly soon. It's all brick-clad, and it will definitely look like something from about 1910. Finally, at the upper end of mid-rise is this new, this is under construction now. It's condominiums, and it's in North Portland. What's one of the things interesting about it, it's timber. So when it's finished, it'll be the tallest timber building in the United States, but it'll only have that title for about a year because it's another taller building under construction. And in Canada, they're building them 20 stories. Interesting little known fact, safer for fires. It takes a lot longer to burn through that wood, laminated wood, than it does for steel to fail. And there are actually steel buildings that have wood wraps around the steel now to retard their collapse. A little bit about low and mid-rise retail and office, including redevelopment. So this is a very common phenomenon. You've seen it here in Davis, which are homes along an arterial that has been a transit route for over 100 years, and they're converted. And so again, I'm only expressing my own thoughts. Many people like a mixture of funky and fancy. When it's all one or all the other, and I feel that way about architectural styles, it's not the same. So you have these renovated buildings, adapted buildings that are kind of charming and a bit funky, and then you have modern condos next to it. And they seem to work well together. This is an adaptive reuse by a pair of brothers, the McMenamins, who are geniuses at this. I will say softly, for some reason their food is never any good. But this is a former grade school that is now a spa, a conference center, overnight lodging, and pub. And it's interesting to walk down, everything's painted inside, they have artists do this work. And you walk, I was walking through this school hallway, you know, and they had images of the children from the 1920s and 30s, and I look out a window and there's people in a hot tub right outside. So it's very different. But they've done a lot of adaptive reuse, and this is in the middle of a neighborhood, and now you have a much different kind of mix of uses there. This building on the left was an old appliance sales store. It's now got creative office space in it. Would do well in this kind of market. You can ask questions about it later. They took a concrete saw to the inside and cut through and openings, put in showers, meeting spaces with roll-up garage doors. It's for people who are graduated from their home office or, you know, their spouse has told them they have to leave or the marriage is over. And they rent up really quickly, and the ground floor is restaurants and different kinds of retail. So a lot of the material, it's designed to be appealing but inexpensive. This is a new mid-rise office, not in downtown. It's one of the surprises is this is now being built in neighborhoods which are highly desirable for young, well-educated millennials. This is actually advanced seismic standard. It's on rockers. Mid-rise and with timber cladding has a nice interior courtyard. This is a larger scale, that's one project, taking advantage in the shift in terrain. It has a hardware store, a grocery store, apartments, professional services. It's just being finished now. It's called Loca at the Goat Blocks, which is an odd name, but what happened was there was a building on the property that was probably built in about 1900 and it burned, and the property was cleared, and it was about 2 acres. And the owners got tired of maintaining it, so they brought a herd of goats in. And it was amazing, the goats became adopted by everyone. People knew their names, they had their own website, and with a webcam, monitor the goats. So when, after 3 or 4 years, they announced that, you know, they were going to redevelop the property, there was all this uproar, and there was a search to find a new location. So the goats were moved to another redevelopment site, which, by the way, is about to be redeveloped. So I don't know if they cause it or just victims of gentrification, but they decided to call it Loca at the Goat Blocks, and they have goat imagery built into it. So this will be finished near the fall, but you can see the goats on the lower left. So it's a very interesting design. There's more intimate spaces. Again, mid-rise. Now, one of the things that seems to have happened on its own was the evolution of small public parks and private spaces that function as public spaces. It's a very simple, there's good examples in Davis, very important, I think, ingredient, actually makes a lot of economic sense. I have a video of the space. This is about seven blocks from our house. It's a food cart pod. And the landscaping is in bins and then gravel and awning. There's 27 food trucks. There's also a double-decker bus that sells dresses and an Airstream bus that sells men's toiletries. And there's music on Friday night. And we go there fairly often in the summer, and we were there last fall, I guess, and I realized the people all around the table were all people from out of town who were coming there because they couldn't get this in their own community. And it's got some mediocre food, and it's got some spectacular food, which is a nice mix, plus beer out of the side of a trailer. So that is a created, and by the way, it's hooked up to the sewer, but they have a steel shipping container that operates as a bathroom. It's actually very creatively designed, all low-tech, very inexpensive, and it's an activator for a neighborhood if you need that. This is a delegation of people from Lansing, Michigan, who we're giving a tour to, and we're having lunch at a new grocery store in a redevelopment area, and what you're looking at is actually the parking lot. So they blend it by having plant sales and other things out there just to create a buffer. So all the space you're looking at is completely private and privately controlled, but of course anyone can come there and have lunch. So it really softens the effect in the entrance of the parking structure across the way. This is another restaurant, Bollywood Theater, at the edge of that redeveloped appliance store. All they did was this is actually the way it was set back, there was parking in front and becomes an area for food and drink. This is a more interesting one. This is a nursery in the middle of a extremely rapidly transforming neighborhood in North Portland. It's called Pistols Nursery, and you walk in through a door and all of a sudden you're in a nursery. You can see it here in this Google image off to the right. You can also see another courtyard to the left. This makes a big difference in your perception. The other thing is, as our retail consultant said, often these buildings are too deep for good retail. You don't want to go into a shoebox. The farther back you go, the lower the price. So there's things you can do. One is if you cut out the space, you actually haven't lost much that's valuable. Light goes back, and you now have a very attractive space for restaurants and other kinds of retail. This is a dressier private space. This is an old motel parking area. And it's a very, very handsome garden. Here's another view of it. And a living wall. That's one of the few examples from downtown. This is a new development, and the use of art I really liked here, and a kind of low-key, quiet space, though, for mid-rise development. This is a little side courtyard in a new development, and on the right, even though it's considered a no-no, is a big grove of bamboo. And the nice thing about the bamboo is it's grows fast, and it has a nice sound when the wind blows, and shade. And actually, we do get hot in Portland, so we need shade. This is an illustration from an affordable housing project with a lot of internal green spaces that can make it welcoming and allow somewhat protected areas for children to play. I got two more downtown images, a pocket park in downtown with a lot of active spaces, a giant chess set there, and water features. And then a small one-acre contemplative park, which is a wetland recreated downtown. So designed not for active recreation. Although a friend of mine who's a naturalist, urban naturalist, said they went there once and people put goldfish in the pond. They're not supposed to do that, right? But osprey came and started removing them. So it made for a little more excitement. Well, now, those are the images. I'm going to talk about programs and policies that support or inhibit infill and redevelopment. And I want to begin with a recognition that our planning and zoning is really based on a paradigm from the 1940s and 50s. And that was a future that we saw unfolding at the time. And that is still very much embedded in our thinking. So here's an image back when America was great. Men smoked and women waited on them. And really, this idea about this is the American dream is still reflected in our plans and regulations. It has a long lifespan. We think, I'm amazed the number of people who think this is the American family, right? Remember them? The Nelsons. You know, Ozzy's dead, June's living alone, you know, Ricky is living with an unmarried partner, and I forgot the youngest one's name. Ricky. David. David's the older one, right? So David's probably living with a man in San Francisco. Ricky is a survivalist somewhere. I mean, that's not true anymore. I'm sorry, these are a little out of order. So in 1970, 46% of households in the United States were one or two persons. It's 62%. So when we think about the housing we're talking about, almost two-thirds of the population are in households of one or two persons. Our regulations are based on the idea that the Nelsons are going to move in. And a third are non-family households, so they're not related, not married. We've been moving this direction for a long time. So this is what America is now. In Yolo County, 22% are two parents with children. So the Nelson family is less than a quarter. And by the way, in Yolo County is not different from the United States, a few percentage points. But this is typical of the United States. About a quarter of the households are two parents with a child. And here, 23% are just one person. So we cannot be thinking about this building the cities for the Nelsons, because that era is gone. Another thing that's going are malls. So there's hundreds of dead malls. This one happens to be in California. I don't know where. and there's many reasons for it, but the fact is that there are hundreds of malls. There's even a website called deadmall.com. I think you can look at stories about malls and when they were alive and why they're dying. Retail's changing. Macy's, this winter they said they're closing 100 stores, including one in downtown Portland. Sears is shutting 30 stores. Sears and Kmart stores by next month. And there are, one after another, the chains are closing their stores. So suburban malls, Ozzie and Harriet, it's over. McDonald's, I remember in the 60s going with my parents to try this new restaurant in the suburbs. And we actually never went again, but it was definitely a phenomena, and it symbolizes a lot about America. This is McDonald's headquarters currently outside Chicago. Until I think next year, they're moving here, downtown Chicago. So employers are moving from the suburbs, and there's a lot of office parks that are now troubled and closing, just like shopping malls. Conagra, maybe one of the largest ag businesses in the United States, they're moving from this location to this location. That's the Merchandise Mart in Chicago. And of course, transportation is changing. And I think a lot of people dismiss this, but if you look at the number of companies that are investing in autonomous vehicles now and the fact they're testing it in a bunch of communities, it may not be coming tomorrow, but it is definitely coming and is definitely going to change things. Which way it changes is highly debatable, but I think the technology is going to be arriving. And perhaps the only thing left from that Jetsons image is this, which may have some of you read a, seen a story about it. It is a taxi drone that's autonomous and it's battery powered. It's supposed to be tested in Dubai this year. So you get in it and you can fly within 50 kilometers. And all that's in front of you is a pad. Now, I'm not going to be the first, but it's a symbol of change. And then, of course, here's another bigger symbol of change. Our planet, our climate's going to be fundamentally different. It used to be called global warming, but it's really climate change. It's more chaotic and unpredictable. And you can't attribute any one event to a system change. But collectively, they confirm what scientists have known about what happens when you add energy to the environment. And it's not just climate change, it's the burden of consumption on the planet and whether it can sustain a population at its present levels. I've been going to China a lot until last year, and it's actually very moving to see a country that was extremely poor have such affluence now. And what you see at meals, though, is from eating at the bottom of the food chain, they're eating at the top of the food chain. And they're not doing anything that we haven't also done. But the scale and speed of it is mind-boggling. I mean, it's just kind of overwhelming. When I go there, I said, I feel like someone from Britain who went to Chicago in 1900. Like, it's overwhelming. And what this means is that China can't feed itself now. It has to have a navy, an air force, communication spy satellites. It's colonized Africa. Are they bad for doing that? No. I might remember we did that. But it means that the burden on our ecosystem to supply what we need is growing very, very intense. So we need to think about getting up higher quality with less quantity. So I'm going to talk about the problem with residential zoning. So this is how we've approached it in Oregon. In Oregon, every city has to zone enough land for all types of housing that are needed, and all types of housing are needed in every community. So every city and every county with urban areas has to have zoning for apartments, manufactured housing, small lots, the whole spectrum. There has to be clear and objective standards for housing. Now, this is maybe the most important thing that you can do. You can have standards like fit into the character of the neighborhood. And that was very deliberate on the part of the policymakers, saying we have to have housing and we cannot allow communities to become exclusive enclaves and exclude people and make them drive distances and keep them out of their schools and so on. That's not an Oregonian approach. So we have to have clear and objective standards for all housing. Then in the Portland metropolitan region, another set of requirements, which were minimum densities for new development, not maximum, minimum. Virtually all residential zones were modified. There were minimum lot sizes were reduced. And then at a regional level, you had to allow accessory dwelling units on all lots in single family zones. This would end with the lot sizes for new construction in the Portland region. So this is single family homes. Now, when you get down to the bottom end, that's actually the size of lots that were built all over Portland when it was a growing city, 4,000 to 5,000 square feet. That was standard. That was for everyone. So we went from more than a quarter of an acre to something that's more like a tenth of an acre. The city of Portland has gone farther, and they've made it a lot easier. We don't have tests about are you same members of the household and so on. You can have a lot of things that would accommodate students in Davis, actually. They made it a lot easier to build accessory dwelling units. Every corner lot can be a duplex. And then it's created zones that are the EX zone and some others that they call just about anything. You probably can't refine, reprocessed nuclear fuel rods and so on, but otherwise it's pretty much open-ended, which is more like even goes beyond form-based zoning in some ways. Now, in California, I know there was an effort to do this with accessory dwelling units, but after the passage of the legislation 1062, cities adopted zoning rules designed to thwart this state policy. So in Los Angeles, adopted zoning requirement that you had to have a 15,000 square foot lot to have an accessory dwelling unit. So they aren't built. Only 20% of the lots are that size in Los Angeles. Portland's poised to go a lot farther now in the single family, most of the single family zoned land to allow a range of housing types that was of the type that was allowed for many years until the 1950s. So very shortly, you'll be able to have an internal accessory unit and an external small backyard cottage on every lot. You'll be able to have fourplexes, duplexes, triplexes, and fourplexes. This is over a large part of the city. We felt this is the only way to accommodate the pressure we're feeling about rising population growth, incomes, and trying to keep the city a place that was accessible. Now about parking, I understand you'll have someone speaking about this who's much more knowledgeable than I am, but this is a big deterrent to infill and redevelopment. Here's a display from the city of Portland of different kinds of parking types. No parking, tuck under parking, surface parking, podium, which means inside the building. Mechanical, everyone know what mechanical parking is? There's a lift and it stacks cars. Well, it sounds like a car has been crushed. That's not what happens, but actually you have a much narrower space, so you can have three cars in a 12 or 15 foot space, and then there's a key or a card and your car is brought out. It just makes it a lot less space intensive for parking cars than underground. But there's huge differences in the price. So if you're building something, you have to, if they say you need two spaces for two bedrooms, you're adding 100, and it's, we want it underground, because you don't want to waste a surface lot in an area that has a lot of value and potential. It's $110,000, the cost of every unit, to put it underground. By the way, in the surface lots, when I talk to people in the Midwest, they say you should put the operating maintenance cost, because snow clearance and so on is actually very expensive. And then in more severe climates, the asphalt buckles. So there's actually a much higher price for surface parking, like in the upper Midwest. And then they did a research on the impact on rents. And I've enlarged the impact on rents. Won't go through it all. It's a very elaborate analysis. So if you're a developer, you have a certain performance to meet depending on who's lent you money. And you can, if the market is unbelievably tight, yeah, you can charge whatever you want, just about. But you have a floor, and you're not going to build anything unless you can at least get a decent return. And if you build in the price of parking, a lot of things are infeasible. And that was very clearly shown in Portland when the parking was reduced, parking requirements. So this is the standard for on-site parking for apartments within 500 feet of a transit street or 1,500 feet of a transit station. 1 to 30 units, no parking. 31 to 40 units, 2/10 of a space per unit. 41 to 50, a quarter of a space per unit. And 51 or more, 1/3 of a space per unit. Now, when some developers have a market segment where they want parking. And so one of the things that's been interesting is watching what the developers who are going to build in parking, what they feel is appropriate, and it's now at 0.6 per unit. So if they're going to build parking, what they do is they only supply 0.6, or if they build more, you have to rent the parking space separately and they can rent it out, which is a much more efficient use. Like if you don't want it, then we'll sell it to someone else, or you can rent it to someone else, or it can go into a pool. But it's 0.6, and when this is actually an increase in the parking requirements, by the way, not a decrease, this is an increase. If you have bike parking or shared, car service, car sharing arrangement, you can get out of some of the parking requirements. The result of this was very rapid construction, a lot of areas that really needed housing, because it finally made sense. They could make money. If they had to do structured parking, they wouldn't build. Just, it wasn't possible. So, by the way, I want you to know that all this happened in Portland without the slightest hint of controversy. All of this has been hard. This is a modest example. This is an office building downtown, no parking. It's actually a 15-story hotel is going to be built in the kitty corner, no parking. Now, if that seems challenging to you, think of Arkansas. So for all non-residential properties, no parking requirement. Now, Fayetteville, Arkansas is about 15% bigger than Davis, but it's not near any big metro area, and it has about 80% of the students at the University of Arkansas as are at UC Davis. So this is not revolutionary now. A lot of places are undertaking this effort. Another inhibition is decision-making speed and delay. I heard for many years, until I worked more with developers, said, well, time is money. What does that mean? It actually means they have a period in which money is available and they have to pay interest on it. And you might think 15 or 20% profit is obscene, but if it's 4 years worth of effort, you know, it's 4 or 5%. And a lot of developers, they use other people's money. They're the ones who set the terms. So I've become more appreciative to what speed can mean. in getting something done and not having a lot of risk and money that's at a very high rate of interest waiting for things to happen. This is from the Legislative Analyst's Office. Local agencies took on average around 2.5 years to approve housing projects that required an environmental impact report. So keep that in mind. In Oregon, the local government has 120 days from the date the application is complete to have a decision. Now, do they always honor that? No, because they can ask for extensions, and if you're a developer, you don't want to make someone really angry that you're going to see all the time. But I would say that it is definitely an aspiration, and the local governments take it seriously. 120 days, start to finish, that includes all local appeals. You have to be done in 120 days. If you appeal a decision from a local government, it goes to a tribunal in Oregon called the Land Use Board of Appeals. They hear virtually all appeals from all local government decisions on land use. And this, for those of you who are concerned about citizen participation, you might be interested in this. If you went to the hearing and spoke, you can appeal. And it does not matter where you live. So let's say you were in Portland, you were bored, you went to a city council hearing, and said, you know, I'm looking at this code, that doesn't seem right. And you testify, you can appeal. Doesn't matter where you live. Because that's regarded as one of the tools for making sure that the laws are properly enforced. So it's very easy to challenge it. But there are no trials. The trial, which is the fact-finding, occurs before the local government. And the local government has a responsibility to find facts that address the law. So the discipline is not put in the court, but sent to local officials to act like judges. It's a role, you may have heard this phrase, called quasi-judicial. As I learned in law school, quasi means not. But it actually means you have to act like a judge. Like, you don't make policy, you have a set of criteria, you have a set of facts. Do you meet the standards? That's it. Not, I'm going to rethink the policy. So that is required. And if it's not met, then the decision can be repealed. Reversed and returned. You have 3 weeks to file the appeal. There are no extensions. It's absolute. 3 weeks, miss it, done. 119 days after the final local decision, you have a decision by the Land Use Board of Appeals. Yes, they can ask for extensions occasionally, but not very often. And it requires the agreement of both parties. So think about this. 119 days after the final local decision, you have an appellate review tribunal, it's completed. If you want, you can go to the Court of Appeals. And the Court of Appeals has to have a decision 168 days after the Land Use Board of Appeals decision. So if you add those all up, it's basically 13 months from the time of the application until you're done through two levels of appeal and all the local government proceedings. Now, does that advantage developers? I don't think so. I think it focuses everyone's attention. It's a very open participatory process, but there is speed and clarity, and I think it makes a big difference in achieving the outcomes you want in your plans. Finally, I'm going to conclude with a very brief quiz and design review. Which is the before and which is the after image? This is being built on our street nearby. Any guesses? How many people think the top image is after design review? Well, maybe about a third. How many think the bottom image is after design review? About a half. The top. So this is one of the issues with design review. And I actually think we have a problem in our city with it. It becomes kind of an unfettered expression of the aesthetic tastes of the architects. It's not clear to me in a lot of cases that it's made any difference, but it certainly does add to cost and expense. So I think there's something to be said for using it sparingly or advisory, but I'm not convinced that it's actually yielding us better designs, with a few exceptions. Well, I'm going to say one thing, and then we can have some conversation, and that is, I think there's a lot of understandable angst about the speed of change. And in our neighborhood, it was very rapid. It was not years, it was 2 or 3 years, and our street was transformed. Homes started to change. And there's sometimes a belief that if we can stop the physical changes, we can preserve what we love about the community. That is, if the buildings stay the same, the place is staying the same. But that is not the case. We're in a very dynamic, rapidly changing world and nation, and you in California are a state at the forefront of these changes. The buildings can be the same and it can be a completely different place, because the people who can live there will only be the affluent. And ultimately, a lot of us in my neighborhood said we would rather have a lot of change and keep the character and mixture of people the same than keep the buildings the same and we can't live here. It's a hard choice, but I think it's one that, you know, we're continuing to grapple with. I'd be glad to answer questions, and thank you for your patience.
Okay, we'll have an opportunity for questions in a few moments. I'm going to ask the three panelists who are sitting here to come on up. I'll introduce you quickly, and we'll need one more chair over here. So what we're going to do is we're just going to, I'll introduce them in a second when they get up here. We're just going to ask for whatever reactions you have to Robert's slides or presentation. Thank you. So we'll start on this end. We have Virginia Thigpen, now retired. Virginia has had a long career as a developer and builder of infill properties in Davis. She's past president of the Downtown Davis Business Association and served on the board of directors of the Chamber of Commerce. Next, we have Stephen Wheeler. Stephen is a professor in the Human Ecology Program at UC Davis. He's the author of three books on how different planning and design strategies can work together to produce more sustainable communities. And then next to Stephen is Mike Webb, who is our assistant city manager and director of, Sustainability and Community Development. Yes, I got it right. Sustainability and Community Development. So in whoever wants to go first, I'd ask you just to take a few minutes, not too much time, just any piece of the presentation that struck you from your perspective that you'd like to follow up on. We'll just hear your comments, and then we'll go immediately to public Q&A after that. Who'd like to go first? All right, Stephen, I see that hand coming up. Go ahead, you're first. Yeah, thanks.
I would like to thank Robert, first of all.
We're going to use these. Thanks.
Okay. I'd like to thank Robert for a wonderful presentation. It's always great to see images of Portland, Oregon, and other regions up there. And looking at them, I am inspired, because Portland has developed a culture of creativity in planning. Historian Carl Abbott has called it the Oregon planning style. It doesn't mean they never have problems and they never make mistakes, but they do have a lot of different players who come together to make things happen. Members of the business community, members, you know, of nonprofit organizations, environmentalists, elected officials, and they just build one thing on another slowly until they have something that's pretty remarkable. And I would love to see us do that a bit more here. Another theme that emerges from Robert's images is that design matters. It matters the specific mix of forms, the variety, ways that vegetation and planting and on-site drainage and things like that maybe are mixed in with buildings. The ways that we have people-oriented spaces, not vehicle-oriented spaces. The ways that we have formal and informal uses of places. And creative moves like opening up the interior of blocks in a downtown to get sort of a three-dimensional space that is fun and vibrant and makes you want to be in that town. How we get good design is an interesting question. Design review boards may not be the way to go. One thing many of us have talked about in Davis that Robert didn't mention is having a form-based code for the downtown, which basically focuses not so much on the uses that go within each building, but the general form and character that we want to see. And that is something I think we'll have more discussion about in this town, and maybe Mike can speak to that as well. And last theme I want to mention is the desire not to become an exclusive enclave, because I think Davis is in great danger of doing that. And I moved to Davis from Berkeley quite a while ago, and Berkeley is also, many places in California are becoming very exclusive enclaves. So we do need to change. We do need to think about new building forms that can accommodate lots of people at different incomes. Things like very small units, things like minimum densities of new development, minimum heights rather than maximum heights. Parking is something that gets in the way of development. I think there's a chance that 10 or 20 years down the line, we won't need so much parking. Maybe because when we walk out the door here, we'll call for an autonomous vehicle that will take us home. Who knows? But I look forward to a discussion on these topics. Creative, a culture of creative planning, making design matter and work for us, and figuring out ways not to become an exclusive enclave. Thank you.
Thank you, Stephen. Mike or Virginia?
Thank you very much. And good evening, everyone, especially taking some time out of a Sunday evening and coming on down to talk about this, I think, very important topic. Stephen Wheeler mentioned, I expect we will be seeing quite a few community conversations moving forward. Our city council has given direction for us to move forward with a update to our core area specific plan, which is our downtown in core area of the city, as a key effort in really advancing that before we do a whole citywide general plan update. In large part, the interest there, I think, is an expressed interest on the city council's part, and staff is very, very interested in this as well, is the idea of taking and utilizing a form-based approach. I would agree wholeheartedly with Stephen that I think as a from a zoning perspective and a land use regulation perspective, we've become very mired in the numbers, with a lot of focus on things like density and how many feet tall a building is, as opposed to how does that building look and feel and interact with the community and the neighborhood. So getting back to those kind of design roots. Some reflective comments on Robert's presentation of, I would say, up until you get to about the mid-rise discussion, interestingly enough, we have very, very fine examples of all the types of projects that Robert went over, from cluster cottage housing at Aggie Village to projects like Peña House, Del Rio Live Work, the Row Building downtown, tall, skinny houses as we're seeing emerge out at villages at Willow Creek, condominiums downtown with Mission Villas on B Street, stacked flat condominiums out at the Cannery. So we have some very, and there's many more that I'm not noting there, but we have some very nice and fine examples of very well thought out, well done projects in this community. How can we do more of those? So as we move forward to the query specific plan update, I think it's a very exciting time for the community to really come around and discuss and really focus the efforts on what is the vision for the community? What do we want to see the downtown and the core area be and become as a community? So those are all things I think that reflect well on Robert's comments, and very much appreciate you coming out and speaking with us.
Thanks, Mike. Virginia.
Hi, well, I'm reflecting on how long it's been since I've been retired. I'm not totally retired, but what I may have to offer is maybe a little more historical perspective, because now when I go downtown, instead of working downtown all the time, I look around and say, wow, this is a wonderful infill development that Chuck or somebody else has done. Some beautiful, beautiful examples of densification. And I think about how hard that would have been to get approved 30 years ago or even 20 years ago. And so I would like to think that it has somehow gotten more streamlined and that there is a better understanding and appreciation for higher density towards a more vibrant and livable downtown. So I think that's very encouraging, and I would also second what Mike said, that we already do have many of the kinds of housing types being created and having been created in Davis. Everything he mentioned, plus at least three excellent co-housing communities, which are higher density and encourage sharing of assets, including cars. Rambling back to downtown, I think that our downtown has a huge, huge advantages, and I'm stating the obvious here, but by being compact and in a grid, and by our terrain being flat and our climate being more or less benign, we are able to do so much more with walking and bicycling than in many cities. And yet I think we still persist in having a very suburban mentality about wanting to get in our car and drive to within 50 feet of our destination. And when I hear Robert's comments about reducing parking requirements, again, back in the day when we were designing a project, you started with the parking, and the parking drove the entire project. So I'm happy to see that changing. However, I think that without an excellent mass transportation, public transportation, or wider acceptance of cycling, even scooters like you see a lot of in Europe, or tiny, tiny cars, it's going to be one of our bigger challenges. As a side note, when my daughter lived in one of the places she lived in San Francisco, there was no parking, but she had a car. And in addition to her rent, I think she paid $300 to $400 a month in parking tickets and damage to her car, not to mention the break-ins. And so you can't, it's very hard to keep the one car to a person expectation and not require some kind of parking. I also think a lot about what it would have been to continue to live in San Francisco if you were juggling a stroller and a baby and groceries and maybe a dog. How do you do that when you park seven blocks away? Which do you leave in the car while you make that trip? So another topic that interests me a lot in this discussion is how design absolutely affects behavior and interaction and community. And I was fortunate enough to cut my teeth in construction in Judy and Mike Corbett's Village Homes, and got to witness firsthand how intentional design of open spaces that encourage community interaction actually caused that to happen, amazingly enough. And I see it everywhere. Right down to, say, clustered senior housing, where you put the mailboxes not on the edge where the postal carrier can get to them easily. You put it in the center under a gazebo with benches around. It's a design decision that gets people out there communicating with each other. So and that's just a tiny example of the kind of ways that design, if done well, can affect the way people live and the quality of life and security, safety, everything like that. So the other swing I have seen in Davis is from projects being approved based on parking and zoning and low density to more like in the mid-70s to 80s, projects given more approval because of compactness and higher density, mixed income housing, and then a swing back to big, large lots and the kind of development where you really don't know what street you're on, no sense of place or community. And in reaction to that, we have now been seeing an attitude of, we don't want any growth. We want nothing, nothing new, nothing more dense, because look what happened. Look what happened out there. We don't want anything. And so we've thrown out in many cases, the baby with the bathwater, in order to not have more bad development, we sometimes fail to recognize when there's a good proposal. So that's what I'm hoping to see more of, and more acceptance of higher density. So when you propose a granny flat behind the house, you don't expect all your neighboring properties to come out in opposition to it, because they're concerned about the traffic and the noise, and you know, you hear that. So it requires a shift, I think, a shift in thinking, and I'm happy to have Robert here as a shining light to help encourage us in that direction and to see that our attitudes really are changing. So thank you.
Thanks. Just one or two reflections from one council member, and I'm glad that my colleagues Brett Lee, Mayor Pro Tem, and Lucas Frericks are here tonight to hear this conversation as well. I think the projects that Mike ticked off around the city that have been approved in the last 2 years, where the greatest diversity is happening in the city right now, are interestingly not in the core. They're around neighborhoods, whether it's the Del Rio live work or the dense single family residence in South Davis. And it shows me that there is creativity happening around the community. And if you don't live in one of those neighborhoods, chances are you're not seeing it. So there is a fair bit of diversity. I think that's encouraging. And I think it shows that even in established neighborhoods or places where zoning would suggest a certain use, there is the potential to do some really creative and attractive places for people to live. The other thing is, I do live in the core. I live in one of those buildings that you know, someone hold up as an example of what we should have in the core, the lofts. And one thing I'll note about it is there are six residential units on the third floor. I rent one of them with my wife. I think I said that right. 1, 2, 3. Yeah, 7. And there are that many parking spaces underneath. And half of those parking spaces are empty most of the time, meaning we have to rent those spaces in addition to our rent, and half of us are opting not to park in those spaces and not to use them. And so the issue of parking I'm just laser focused on that. The parking densities that were shared from the Portland experience, which you, if I heard you right, Robert, you said that they had been increased over what had been proposed. To me demonstrates the future of our city, but I have to combine that with the reality that we still do have, I think, arguably a largely suburban mentality, where even fairly short distances are viewed as necessitating a motorized vehicle. I'm not sure, as a policymaker, it's not clear to me where, you know, when the dam is going to break, when we're going to start actually having some places that are proposed with very, very low parking ratios that we will accept by exception and see what happens, whether we're already seeing it and just not seeing it, which is what I think is happening, and what we do about the question of storage. University town, there are parents, some of you in this room are those kinds of parents, who want their kids to have cars at school so that they can get home if they need to or do other things that they may need to do. And so the question, in my mind, at least in relation to some of the projects that are coming before us, is how do we encourage or enable or discourage or not enable longer-term storage of cars, where people literally are not getting them out even once a week, perhaps, but have them there because someone else in their life is suggesting you should have a car there while you're at university. So those are just some comments and reflections briefly on what was said. I saw someone handing out envelopes. What was that, Alan? Okay, good. There's your one pitch for a contribution. This is not covered by the City of Davis. We do donate the space, but we are glad to take contributions so that the ad hoc organizers can continue this. I'm going to ask Lucas to come on down and help me out. The way we're going to do it is Lucas will have a roving mic. I'm going to just see where the questions are and sort of say, your turn. Here's the deal. Find your question in your comment really quickly. So if you're finding yourself rambling off into a comment, find your question. If you don't find your question, I'm going to ask you to find it. So I saw this hand first, then we'll go there, and then we'll go there.
Thank you. Can I stand? You
can stand. If you want to say your name, you're free to. You don't have to.
My name is Larry.
Want to address your question to one person, that'd be great.
Well, this is sort of to the city, because my name is Larry Crane. I'm a retired civil engineer, environmental hydrologist. I've been involved in some level in sustainability and natural systems since the early 70s. The key to me in this is the automobile. When will we recognize that the personal automobile is not part of a sustainable infrastructure and actually take an aggressive action to do something about it? If it's a chicken and egg question, well, people need to have transportation before they get out of their cars, let's get out of the cars. Let's make an electric-based public roving transportation system the center of what we do in Davis. Because we had an opportunity with Village Homes on having sustainable infrastructure that recognized certain other elements besides transportation, particularly stormwater management, which is a new big deal. We dropped that ball, so let's not drop the ball again. I'd like somebody to give an analysis of how much the value of the space is from the parking in front of your house to your driveway to your garage that would be worth given the value of property these days. And if that brings in additional revenue to the city in terms of tax revenue, then that revenue can be used to create the system that will make it possible to have zero parking developments. And that's just that one aspect that I think will really kick things off.
It wasn't really a question there, it was a comment. I think I asked for questions. We'll make sure we get questions in the future. Anybody want to react to that? Mike, I'm sure, has that back of the envelope calculation of the value of the land right there.
Yeah, no, I'm sure that price tag would probably be tremendous, though. Sure, just seeing from the numbers that Robert had up on how much it cost to construct a parking space, I think, what, 20,000 roughly you had in there for structured parking garage, for example. I'd probably argue that's probably on the low side for California. It's probably upwards of 30 plus here from what I've seen. So that value is tremendously high. I think the key, you mentioned two key words. One is system. And you know, absolutely, transportation is looked at and has to be looked at as a system. Where and how does Davis, you know, our community fit within that system in the region, for example? And what can we be doing and working with SACOG, with Capital Corridor, with our other regional partners to be better interconnected than we currently are, to give that option, you know, make that option readily available for folks to make that decision, like, I'm going to forego the car, the vehicle. The other just key piece to this, I think this kind of that systems puzzle is jobs and jobs housing balance. And that's something that, you know, communities are often looking at, which is where are we relative to not only how many jobs we have within the community, vis-a-vis housing within the community, but are they matched, you know, or are folks needing to find themselves going elsewhere, commuting, if you will, elsewhere to Sacramento or the Bay Area, or even farther in some cases to find those positions. So no silver bullet answers by any means. It's an incredibly complex topic, but one that absolutely is worth diving into.
And I would say, as he's passing the mic, I mean, the next generation may be making the decision for us. I don't know how many of you have kids who are opting out of automobiles for long periods of their lives, some not adopting them at all, even well into their 30s. I think Robert had one quick thing he wanted to add to that, and then we'll go on to the next question.
I was impressed during the dinner conversation about all the opportunities for extension of existing transit service here that may be cost effective. So you may be close to providing those kinds of options. The other thing is safety is a primary determinant about bicycle use for transportation. In Europe, there's actually a segment of the population identified by age over 75 who use bikes. So I've commuted to work on a bike for 25 years, and now I'm looking at the backs of people passing me on the bikes, and when they go past, some of them are definitely older than I am. And I think one of the reasons it happened is we're getting more and more segregated bike lanes. So you have a great climate, flat terrain, a reputation, infrastructure. Between those two things, I can't imagine you can't do something pretty breathtaking.
And e-bikes are coming down in cost. You're next.
Hi, Jean Jackman. I wonder if in Portland at some point you had granny flats, where granny flats were infill, if you had a limitation on the number of cars, because I see granny flat going into my neighborhood. And they're university students, but four of them have a car, and the granny lives in the back unit. And so you've got five cars then. And I think that's more feels more objectionable than infill of more people.
One of the differences between what I described and what you experience here is a university town where you have a lot of press from student housing. So I don't think the experience of Portland is that relevant for that issue. I do think that some universities are being more aggressive about how they, whether they authorize or not, students to have cars. And some of that is done out of respect for the host community.
Hmm. We're going to go here, and then we're going to go to the back. I saw this hand, and then I saw that hand back there.
Hi, Elizabeth Dubin. So your presentation was very compelling, and we all have heard how wonderful Portland is, even if we haven't been there. So you expressed a couple different ways that Portland is like Davis, and I agree, but there are pretty obvious ways that it's not like Davis, and one of them is the existing building stock and the type of buildings that we have here. So Portland and many other cities have something very different to work with when they're creating these mixed-use environments. They have a lot of large turn-of-the-century commercial factory buildings, and you can carve things out of them, you can make courtyards in them. And we're kind of going the opposite direction, where we have low-density, small, not terribly substantial housing stock spread out, and then we have these isolated retail areas. So we have, I'm not talking about the core, but retail areas. Neighborhood shopping centers. So I'm wondering your thoughts on how we take what we have, which is different than what you have, and how do we build up the same kind of rich, mixed-use, overlapping, multi-layered community without what I consider a very important ingredient to start with.
It's a good question. There's obviously big differences in the building stock, but actually of the new housing that I've mentioned, you saw images of, overwhelmingly it's new, brand new from scratch. The mixed use kind of makerspace and commercial use the existing stock of warehouses. It's why the price is so high, because it's a very limited quantity. Now replicas of it are being built. I mean, it's really obvious. Brand new buildings look like old buildings. So most of the new housing is new. I think the opportunity to reuse even mid-century shopping centers, there's a lot of creativity around that. And God knows we have plenty of it in California. People look at that and ignore it. We have a consultant we've used in California, Michelle Reeves, who goes to tilt up warehouses and shows how they can be made something wonderful. And I think with buildings like that, it really is important to preserve each era, some parts of it, as long as you can make it useful and give it some utility and make money for those who are going to do the redevelopment. So. Another example is the suburbs. Huge amounts of the suburbs of the United States don't fit what we are now. And to me, some of the most exciting projects are, those are really interesting. How do you redesign those homes? How do you create some commercial uses to create some vitality and opportunity, not to have to spend a gallon of gas to get a gallon of milk? So I think you have opportunities to do things with a later building stock that will apply to more of the United States. And we've got more than enough creativity in this town and in this state, I think.
Back there.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I just want to piggyback on
if you could, maybe it'd be helpful to stand
I
up.
I don't
thanks.
Like to stand. I grew up in Portland, and I want to piggyback on what you were saying. I grew up in Southeast Portland, and I would walk around, and I was so disappointed that I couldn't find a place to get a fun thing to drink or something to eat in Southeast Portland back in the 70s. So we just have to take what we have and let it go from there and be creative with what we have, like that strip mall by the co-op or over by Pina Drive, that little strip mall, or out at Lake Boulevard, that's, you know, the strip mall or whatever you want to call it, the shopping area. You can do so much with what you have, and then the people in the neighborhoods will go there. And we just can't forget about the surrounding areas. We keep talking about downtown, but every little neighborhood, I mean, finally, like Belmont and Hawthorne and Laurelhurst down on 28th and Ankeny, I mean, those were nothing. And now they're everything. I mean, they're just, you can walk from where I grew up to all these amazing places. So you just have to take what you have in your neighborhood and just make it funky and interesting. Put it up an umbrella and a little bistro chair and,
yeah. I'm gonna do this one, and then
we'll go over there.
Okay, yeah.
And then we got some other folks.
Yep. Sorry, I'm not seeing everyone. I'm trying to look. Go ahead.
Hello, I'm David Sandino. I have a question for Professor Liberty.
I'd like you to comment about the streamlining of the environmental review and what goes into the environmental review in Portland and whether there's an Oregon equivalent of CEQA. And then I have a question for the entire panel as what changes, if any, would you like to see for the environmental review process in Davis?
So I'm going to have to speak in generalities because, as everyone knows, there's lots of details and complexity to anything to do with land use regulation or environmental review. The short answer is there's no CEQA equivalent in Oregon at all. There's no environmental impact reports required at all for anything. The approach was we're going to have a plan, and we're going to execute the plan, and we'll look at impacts in the aggregate rather than doing them case by case. It's a little oversimplified because the city of Portland does have some overlay zones, but it's just, it's completely different. It's like a fork in the road. We said we're going to focus on the planning and not do the permitting, and California took a different approach. I will say that the California approach for certain kinds of resources has yielded better results than we have in Oregon, but I think we're pretty happy with what it's meant in terms of urban and urban development and execution of urban plans.
Thank you. David, thanks. A good question. So from a kind of a city staff perspective, I would say that with respect to CEQA, I think the greatest need is to better, and this involves a whole lot of a wholesale change to the process, but it's a better, what it needs is a better merging of disclosure and policy consideration. Right now, CEQA is designed, it's really structured to be a disclosure process and document. That's its intent. Whether it's truly working very well that way is very questionable. The CEQA document doesn't tell you whether you should proceed with a project or not. That's what the policy decisions are for. A CEQA document is intended to inform that process. And oftentimes, I think just the role of CEQA gets very muddied very quick in California. But and it's, I think, strayed a bit from its original intended purpose when it was first conceived.
I'd like to add to that if I could. I agree with the direction Mike's taking it, and I think there's some things underway with CEQA that I greatly value that I think we need to look at more seriously. One is two things that I would put together. One is moving in a direction of looking at vehicle miles traveled as an impact, and what a given development will do with that. But you can't separate that from, I don't think, an examination of an alternative that says the growth is going to go somewhere. One of the problems that I have with CEQA as it's often conceptualized is it seems to pretend that if this development or whatever it is we're considering doesn't happen here, it simply doesn't happen. And that arguably in a growing region, in a growing state, in a growing world is just not true. And so we're left with this picture that somehow the impacts have gone away because we didn't do something, when in reality we may actually be adding to the impacts. And I think that level of analysis needs to be much more critically done. I'm often left feeling like I really don't know because I'm really not asking. And so it's kind of a question of making sure we're asking the right questions at this point in time. That'd be my perspective.
Anyone else from up in the panel want to answer that at all or not? We've got Carrie Dean, one in the back. I'll come back and talk to you. They've got Dennis over here.
I think we'll take maybe four more questions. So we have one.
Katie and one in the back here. Yeah, and
okay, great. We'll go with those. And if there's anyone else with a burning, because we want to get you out of here soon, but we want to hear the question. So go ahead, Catherine.
Did you want Steve to respond first?
Yeah, go ahead, Stephen.
I'm going to sidestep CEQA, but since we brought up the environmental topic, I was very glad you had climate change in there. And we need to, as a city, be a global leader in responding to climate change. And every new building, in some way, if I think it's possible, it needs to be zero net energy. We need to start thinking about that kind of thing. That's the environmental impact that really matters.
Thank you.
Hi, Katie Brinkley. I'm a planner and also a mother and recently moved to Davis. And one of the things that brought us here is Davis has amazing public schools compared to the surrounding area and just in general. And I noticed your talk hopped over school quality and affordable housing. And I wonder if you could tell us a little bit about how those two components changed in Portland over the years with the zoning changes.
Well, nationally, the phenomena of the decreasing number of households with children meant that school quality was less of a determinant of where people live, which is one reason so many places have undergone revitalization, because school did not matter. Portland public schools are pretty good, and compared to place in the Midwest, you know, 95% of the children in the city go to public schools and don't go to private schools. I don't think they're terrific. And they're variable, and it has a big difference on where people live. There's another underlying problem, too, which is school choice within a school district tends to reinforce racial segregation. So I think what has happened, though, very interesting from the perspective of the school district, is they're not selling any more property because their schools are filling up. And they're now having to lease space because the school population is going up. Now, that's really an effect of the whole city being revitalized and people moving in. It's a large-scale phenomena. But at least we're not wasting public resources and they're selling off school property because there isn't a need for it. As for affordability, our response to that is increase the volume of construction because the demand is in the core. That's where the greatest displacement is occurring. We've had the largest shift of low-income African Americans moving out, being, you know, way out toward the edge. And so unless we do something, then we'll get more. In fact, downtown Portland, people say, wow, it's really white. And I said, go to the suburbs. You'll see a lot more diversity. So it's a huge challenge. It's not unique. You know, a lot of cities in California are doing this. So I can only give a partial answer. I can tell you this. If your school catchment area district is all low-income people, no amount of money will fix the education. It's just impossible. So you want to have a mixed income community. I think that is healthy and necessary for democracy. And that will be expressed in I think, civic engagement and in schools.
Go ahead. Hi, thank you for your presentation. My name is Craig Zimmerman. My question has to do with transportation and is directly also related to walkability and biking. In 2015, a TomTom Travel Index rated Portland as the number 10 congested city in America, on par with Washington, D.C. And the Portland Bureau of Transportation projected 260,000 residents by 2035. Your slide mentioned a quarter million. What was left out, and this goes to my question, was that they also predict a half a million more daily solo trips of vehicles by that time. And I'm really concerned, what would the impact be in the area of transportation and what that would mean for being able to walk and bike? Thank you.
First, let me talk about the data that talks about congestion. So this is the way it's calculated. Your travel time versus posted speed is what determines the delay, not the actual travel time. So if you're on a road that's supposed to be 60 miles an hour free travel, and you're traveling at 30 miles an hour, then that's 30 minutes of delay. If you it doesn't matter how long it is, right? So the trips are shorter in Portland because it's more compact. So we actually have shorter or average travel times compared to other places. So you're going through traffic, and the traffic has gotten pretty bad. You're going through traffic for 30 minutes, and it's slow. That shows up as a higher level of congestion, as opposed to someone driving the exact same amount of time and covering twice the distance. To me, that's a nonsensical bit of data. It's based, you know, all you have to do to eliminate the congestion, say the speed limit's now 30. Now they're traveling at the maximum speed, right? So I don't buy those congestion ratings. I think they're silly. The second point is congestion is a price for some things, but the question is, what do you get out of it? And, you know, what's the trade-off? You can't make all the travel free and with no congestion. I mean, there wouldn't be any community left. So the answer is, we have to redesign the communities to make a lot less trips necessary and to bring things closer together. One of the problems with being a successful place is congestion. And places that are popular are congested, and people accept it. I don't have to deal with this because I bike. My commute is often the best part of the day, right? And I get to go over a beautiful bridge, and I get a lot of fresh air, even if it's pouring rain, you know. So when I'm in congestion, I hate it with a passion because I'm not used to it. But it's not like you can just fix that. And there's a price to fixing it, a very real price in the community and out of the taxpayers. So I think we are going to have a problem. And we do see people resettling, and we see people choosing not to drive. and making locational decisions to avoid getting on that freeway. Now, that said, my partner has a commute in the morning, gets up at 4:30 now, and it's pretty bad. But the answer is there's nothing, you know, we can make better use of what we have. I guess one other thing I'd say, and it came about in a comment during some work I was doing in Lake Tahoe, as I said, 75% of the cars are empty, 75% of the space inside the cars are empty, right? So we actually have a lot of travel with a lot of opportunity for better use, and I think we will see some of that in coming years through ride hailing and ride sharing services. But for a lot of communities, I think they ought to have a goal of having congestion.
We'll go over here with a question.
I find myself living in Old North Davis, an area that's ready for densification, and I find myself a part of an empty nester household. And I thought, well, I would like to have a granny flat in my backyard. So I went off to Clayton Homes, the biggest seller of modular homes, and I said, I would like a little 325 square foot unit for my backyard. And they said, we only sell real housing. Our smallest unit is 850 square feet. We're not all in Portland anymore, are we?
Well, a little bit of history. I'm trying to remember the name of the big development outside Los Angeles that was the analog to Levittown. It was called Lakewood, yeah. Well, the size of those homes, by the way, were, you know, 750 up to about 1,100 square feet, and those would have two or three generations and people with kids in it. No one thought that was living in poverty. People come to our house, which is a 1945 house you saw, and say, oh, it's so charming for a small house. And I think, there's two of us. I don't like vacuuming, right? So, and I think increasingly young people are saying, why do I don't want to be burdened by debt. I want other things out of life than home payments. So I think you're seeing a lot of creativity about design. I've actually been in a house about 320 square feet in a project in our neighborhood that actually I didn't care for, but it was done by a national home builder, so it was very impressive and seemed experimenting, but it was a 360 square foot studio. I was quite impressed. I said, this is quite a nice unit. It was pretty cheap. So I think we'll see more of that experimentation.
I would encourage you to look at Sacramento. There's a Facebook page, Sacramento Tiny Houses. If you haven't looked at that, there's not a lot of going on there. But what is going on is kind of interesting, and you see what's out there and what people are thinking about in terms of construction. I think we're going to go to our last question of the evening. Oh, sorry, Mike.
I just add very briefly to Dennis's comment. With accessory dwelling units in Davis, we've actually come quite a ways just in the last few years with from the regulatory review side, where a unit as one that Dennis describes, 325 square feet or roughly, whether it's a component of the house or whether it's in the yard, if space allows, is basically a staff level over the counter review. And then obtaining building permits. City of Santa Cruz has taken an interesting next step beyond that, which is actually the city worked with a group of local architects and came in and actually pre-designed and pre-plan checked for building permits a variety of different accessory unit designs, so that if someone is interested, they come in, they know it's already approved, it's already been through the building permit review process, and they can basically get over the counter, go to work on an accessory unit. That is, there's been some interest in the possibility of looking at something like out here and taking Davis to that next step too.
Yeah, thanks. Well, we'll go to the last question, Todd.
Okay, what an honor. My name's Todd Edelman. I live in Green Meadows, where it's pretty difficult to shop by foot, and so I kind of feel bad for the people who even further away in Wild Horse. And I think also where the cycling modal share is probably a half or a third of what it should be for this year, based on goals set a few years ago. So anyway, while we have the statistics about the really great Portland parking requirement policies, which had a, you know, quite low compared to Davis, could somebody possibly from the city staff or elected official actually, while that's on our mind, those percentages from like 0.2 to 0.3 or so, maybe somebody could find it. What are actually the requirements in Davis right now?
I can tell you pretty quick. The requirements that we have for the most part on the books in our zoning have been there since the 80s. They fundamentally haven't changed. They've been reviewed and reconsidered on a project-by-project basis. And I will tell you that, for example, a one-bedroom or studio unit in our zoning code requires one parking space. An accessory unit, up until recently, required an additional parking space in addition to the home. Two-bedroom apartment requires, it's 1.5 spaces equivalent per unit, and it kind of goes up from there. So it's very parking intensive, generally speaking. On more recent projects of larger scale, Mission Residences, which is the 14 units of stack flat condos under construction currently on B Street, has partial underground parking in its just a touch over a space a unit, and those are two-bedroom units. Projects like looking at West Village, so going on to UC Davis campus for a moment, they're parking at a ratio of about 0.6 spaces a unit.
That's after double up, Mike.
After doubling up on the rooms. And then projects like Sterling, the Sterling apartment proposal, which is currently undergoing a review process, is about 0.6, 0.65, I believe, is about the ratio we're seeing. And those are ratios that developers seem to have a comfort with, and it seems like where they landed when they ratcheted back up in Portland. So it's always about, it's finding that sweet spot of, you know, in requiring minimum parking and how much is too much. Versus, you know, too little, and what is the market going to demand? So.
Well, I think we should give a round of applause to Robert and to the panelists. Thank you. Thanks a lot again for coming, and have a good evening.